My name is René Williams. I am assistant professor at the Molecular Photonics Group at the University of Amsterdam. And today we'll talk about the reactivity of molecular oxygen in its ground state and especially in its excited state. Today, I hope to convince you that the Lewis structures of excited states can be very useful and give a lot of insight, simplifying the results obtained from quantum chemistry. I will also show you that the reactivity of the singlet excited state of molecular oxygen is very similar to the ground state reactivity of ozone. We will start with something simple. We'll start with two simple molecules, N2 and O2. Please think about their Lewis structures. So please, in your head or on paper, draw the Lewis structures of molecular nitrogen, N2, and of molecular oxygen, O2. You probably know one part of the periodic system, BCNOF. So we know that carbon has 4 valence electrons. So we need to draw 5 electron pairs around N2 and 6 electron pairs around O2. We all know that a sandwich can be packed under nitrogen to keep it fresh. Now think about what will happen if you pack a sandwich under oxygen. Your sandwich will become inedible very, very quickly. It will become rancid. It will soon look like you would have left it for a week, and it will look like that in a few minutes. The Lewis structures of N2 and O2 are very similar, but the nature of the molecules is very different. Why is oxygen so different? What happens if you pour oxygen over a magnet? You all probably know what happens if you do that, and some of you may even have performed the experiment. It sticks. Molecular oxygen sticks to a magnet because it is paramagnetic. It has magnetic properties. So we can wonder, why does molecular oxygen react to a magnetic field and nitrogen does not? This is related to the molecular orbital scheme that we obtain from quantum physics. We need quantum physics to understand oxygen. So we cannot understand this simple molecule unless we use advanced models. Lewis structures are wonderful, but they are not fully valid here. And this is how we can visualize quantum physics. We have waves, we have wave patterns. Haxi is Axi. You've heard it before. There's a wave function, there's a Hamiltonian, and there's an energy. So that's what we need. And if we do that for oxygen, from quantum physics, this is what we get as a result. We get a triplet ground state. I am going to show you the full MO scheme in a minute, but the results from quantum physics imply that there's a triplet ground state. We have 2 unpaired electrons with parallel spin, and they form the ground state of oxygen. It's a triplet state. So oxygen is a ground state triplet. That's rather uncommon. So it has some bi-radical character. So it's a little bit like you put your sandwich into a radical polymerization process. Molecular oxygen, a very simple molecule, it has a triplet ground state. It has bi-radical character. It's very reactive, and we can visualize this with this structure. So this is a Lewis structure representing the triplet ground state of oxygen. That is what we learned from quantum physics, and this is the MO scheme. This here at the top is the important part that shows the triplet character, but on the whole, it shows the bond order. So the bond order of molecular oxygen is 2. So we do need the normal Lewis structure to represent the bond order, but this structure, this representation, it shows the triplet state, so a bi-radical character with parallel spins. I would say that both Lewis structures are equally important, about 50-50, and that is why we say radical character. It's not 100% the bi-radical structure. So that is the ground state of molecular oxygen. It is essential for us, and here you see the orbitals. So basically, these electrons are in 2 orthogonal pi-star orbitals. Oxygen is a triplet ground state, and it is very important for our existence. We see that we need quantum physics to explain its properties. What about the excited state? If you have a molecule in a triplet excited state, like this enterocene molecule here, it can interact with triplet ground state molecule oxygen, and you can get singlet oxygen formation. The enterocene molecule goes to the ground state. That is triplet excited state quenching by molecular oxygen, and it works quite well. So we have now refreshed your memory on the triplet ground state of molecular oxygen, parallel spins, and the magnetic behavior. What about the excited state? Using molecular orbital schemes like before, we can now not only visualize the ground state, but also two singlet excited states. This is the ground state here in green. We have a triplet state, and we can excite the triplet ground state and go to the singlet excited state. It actually absorbs at 765 nanometer. How do we know this? Because there's actually a dip in the solar spectrum. If you have a look at the AM1.5 solar spectrum, you can see the absorption of molecular oxygen. So we are creating singlet oxygen in the atmosphere here. But what happens to the scheme? So if we go from the triplet ground state to the open shell singlet excited state, just one electron flips. So this singlet is higher in energy, and the two electrons are in separate orbitals. So that's why we call it the open shell singlet state. Now you may expect that this would be a very reactive state, but actually it goes very fast onto the delta form, onto a lower singlet excited state, which is the closed shell singlet. This is the standard form of molecular oxygen, the delta form, and it is the closed shell singlet excited state. What does that mean? Well, it means that the electrons are now paired, and we can actually monitor the emission of this form of singlet excited state, singlet oxygen, by monitoring the emission at 1270 nanometer. We have done that a lots of times in the recent past. Upon excitation of the ground state molecular oxygen, we go into the open shell singlet excited state with the electrons in separate orbitals. Then the electrons form a pair and we get into the closed shell singlet excited state. So this here in red, that is the MO scheme of the closed shell singlet excited state of molecular oxygen. So for a simple molecule, if we look at the excited state, this is what we get. And we can now go one step further, at least we can try. So this here is the ground state of molecular oxygen. It is a triplet. This Lewis structure shows the bond order of two. These Lewis structure show the triplet character. We can draw two dots, the electrons, but they have the same spin, the same electron spin. The spin of the electron, of course, it can be up, it can be down. We can also say it is either alpha or beta. Both electron spins are beta, or both electron spins are alpha. And okay, we can move the electron pairs or the radicals. So these three structures, they all represent in a similar way the triplet ground state of molecular oxygen. As discussed before, these three structures here on the right, they represent about 50% of the character. But now we excite it. So if we take the ground state and we excite it to the open shell singlet excited state, we get here, one of the electron spins, it flips. So we get to the open shell singlet excited state. Okay, by using the MO scheme, we can do the same for the closed shell singlet. So then one of these electrons pairs with the other. So they form electron pair, and we can visualize this by putting the electron pair on one of the atoms. So this represents a Lewis structure of the closed shell singlet excited state of molecular oxygen. And we can draw two resonance forms where the charges exchange places. So here we see two resonance forms of the closed shell singlet excited state of molecular oxygen. Now, if you look at this closely, this oxygen is negative and this one is positive. It's a resonance structure. So we can move the electrons around. We can also draw it like this. But you can wonder, have you seen something like this before? So what does this remind you of, if anything? This may remind you of something that's also in the atmosphere. It's ozone. Think about the hole in the ozone layer. This is a resonance structure of ozone, of O3. It represents the 1-3 dipolar character of the reactivity. So it's a resonance structure of ozone, of O3, in the ground state. It is very similar to the closed shell single excited state of molecular oxygen. So we can anticipate that the reactivity will also be similar. The closed shell single excited state of molecular oxygen, it looks a bit like the ground state of ozone. We have to notice that one of the oxygen atoms has a sextet. It has only 6 electrons around it. So it does not have a noble gas electron configuration. It does not have an octet. It wants to react. And we see that carbon monoxide, CO, has a similar tritter ionic resonance structure, and it's also toxic. This is ozone, it's O3. If you put all the electrons and the charges together, this is what you get. This is the resonance structure. These are more the familiar ones with the plus and the minus next to each other. But ozone can react with double bonds, and then you get this 5-membered ring structure, the so-called mole ozonide. To fully understand the reaction of ozone with double bonds in the so-called pericyclic reaction, we actually need quantum theory. We need the molecular orbital theory. Basically, singlet oxygen can do the same trick. So this here is a reaction that we used last year, and the double bond of this singlet oxygen sensor, it reacts similar to the reaction with ozone, and it forms this product, which then decomposes, and it results in a chemiluminescent reaction. So it is chemiluminescent detection of single oxygen. So in that way, you can correlate quantum physics and molecular orbital schemes, and you can make a translation back into Lewis structures that are maybe more easy to interpret, and certainly easier to correlate to the properties. So if we study a material and the interaction with light, we may need to look at advanced models. But after that, we can actually go back. We can go back to simple Lewis structures of excited states, and it's actually what we do a lot. So we can try to simplify the complex calculations and represent them in a much more simple way, in a simple picture that you can understand and use to predict reactivity. We can use Lewis structures of excited state as a tool to understand our systems better. And we can incorporate the electron spin by indicating the alpha or the beta. Have I told you anything new today? I hope that about 80% of what I told you, you already know. But this here, all this together, I think that it is less known. I think it's new. And I do believe that it is very rudimentary. I consider it textbook material. And that's why I wanted to run this by you today. Thank you.